Hello, Robert here. Hello, how's things?
Yeah, very good. That was a quick answer. I don't think it even rang.
It was just beside, the phone was just beside my table. So.
All right, okay.
Yep.
Already.
Yes.
So whereabouts in England are you?
I'm in Plymouth.
Oh, Plymouth, right, yeah.
Yes.
Okay, we've got some visitors coming from Plymouth. Well, virtually. And I think, yeah, sometime in April. That's good.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I have been once. Yeah, I've been to Plymouth once. I remember it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Not the prettiest of places, but never mind.
No, all I can remember is by the harbour there and a big concrete sort of curved bit. I don't know. That's a bit of stuck in my mind anyway.
The Barbican's nice, but the rest of it's just modern buildings. There's nothing special about most of it. But the Barbican, yeah. the harbour area is quite nice.
Right. Yeah, that's a bit of an interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that, I know what we were speaking about the other night. I don't know if you've heard much of what I was saying. It's very busy there, wasn't it? So.
Yes, I'm sorry about that. It was my fault. Yeah. I was in a very busy place, but we touched base briefly, so thank you for spending the time to talk to me. And yes, I've done some preparation. I've been looking through the chapter 54, lesson 54, the role of the faithful and discreet slave.
Yeah. So I wonder, from what you said then, you said that you have the view that it doesn't refer to an institution. I mean, there's obviously a very strong prevailing view for many years now that any organized religion is a bad thing, that we just do it ourselves and we pray to God as we see fit, and but there's no kind of organized group that should meet together. Obviously, there's a lot of corruption in religion, and people, that's one reason why people shy away from that kind of thing. So is that where you're coming from with that kind of viewpoint?
I bailed out in 2010. I'd had enough. I didn't want to know. I used to be in an evangelical fellowship. I tried a few, and I don't want to know. I'm not interested.
Yeah. So is the principle of organized religion completely out for you?
There's nothing in the Bible against having a religion that is organized. There's nothing against buildings. Okay, there's no verse that says you can't have a church building. But what happens is religions start with the best of intentions. Really godly, fine men like John Wesley come along and they have an idea about getting back to the Bible, and they do so with the best of intentions, and often they achieve an awful lot for God. You know, John Wesley, people like him, achieved an awful lot. But as the years go by and people like him die off and the second and third generation come along, then the focus goes on to buildings. And if you have buildings, you have to have people in charge of buildings. So you give people special titles, maybe they have special robes or clothes or titles, and then they need a salary and they need a pension, and in the old days a horse, but now they need a car. And if you have a car, you have to have insurance and a mobile phone, and in the end, you're just paying for buildings and you're just paying for a system. It moves away from its original aim. And many religions are like this. They start with the best of intentions. And often people like John Wesley are very godly men. But they start off focusing on preaching the gospel to the lost. And they end up with an obsession with buildings and titles and rank and demanding money from people in some cases. You know, tithing is something that I've studied and found extremely, extremely interesting. Because it's something that's taught today. It's a false system that's taught today that you must pay your tithe. It's all about money and power over people and control. And a lot of human institutions end up this way. So, you know, am I against organized religion? Well, no. If there was a man like John Wesley, on the scene today, and I'd probably want to associate with him. But what I see are people who are completely half-hearted about the things of God. They're far more concerned about their status, their rank, their title, the income that they get, the money, the free house, the free car, the salary, the pension, nepotism, promoting their son or daughter into leadership positions. My own background is in the Pentecostal church. Now, leadership in many Pentecostal churches is husband and wife. The wife is a co-pastor. It's unfortunately that you then have a system. And the problem with organized religion is you can't challenge it. I mean, there are some people, and I respect them. They will remain a part of organized religion. They'll try and change it from within. And I have nothing but respect for those people. But I think it's doomed to failure because the church system will not be corrected. Unfortunately, it would be great if you could change your religion from within. And if people want to try that, then do so with my blessing. But unfortunately, it rarely happens because people are more concerned with the buildings and the money and the status and the rank than they are with the Bible. And so unfortunately, what then happens is you have splits. So the Lutherans split from the Catholics, and then other people split off from them, and other people split off from them. It's very, very sad.
I don't know how many, 40,000 denominations, there's all sorts of different counts of it, but there's so many.
Well, there's split offs from the Jehovah's Witnesses. Okay.
Yeah, there are groups that form, but we are, I don't know how much you do know about us. Obviously, you studied the yellow book, so that's the one. I was wondering what it was, because it turned blue. It was yellow at first, but it was
yes. The
blue version. What does the Bible teach us? I think it was renamed. So, we're in 230, just about every country on the earth, 235 countries, all different nationalities, and the unity, I mean, I've tested it out in many, many different countries, it is like nothing. I just cannot imagine more unity, not uniformity, but unity among us. And all the things you're saying are absolutely, we don't have religious titles, only biblical ones, elder. For example, but even that's not used as a title in the sense that some might use it. But no payments, there's no salaries given,
I thought the governing body and the people who work at Bethel got a salary.
They get their food, their needs covered that way, so that's it. That's all it is. Yeah, it's just to keep them alive, basically. They sign a vow of poverty. That's a requirement. So they can't get more money than what's covering their needs.
Right. I've got chapter 54, lesson 54 in front of me, the role of the faithful and discreet slave. That's one I'm particularly interested in. Thank you.
Have you come to definite conclusions on this then, or is it just a case of finding out more information on it?
I don't think there is a group called a faithful and discreet slave. This is just a parable. Your book seems to present this as some sort of group. I'll just read the introduction to lesson 54. Jesus is the head of the Christian congregation. Today, from his position in heaven, Jesus directs his followers on earth by means of a faithful and discreet slave. Having received an appointment from Jesus himself, the slave would have a certain amount of authority, but would remain a slave of Christ and serve Christ's brothers. Who is that slave? How does the slave care for us? I don't see any organized appointment of a faithful and discreet slave. This is just a parable where Jesus is telling people to be ready, be prepared for the two things he's just prophesied about, the destruction of the temple, which happened in AD 70, and his second coming and the end of the age, which hasn't happened yet, though I don't think it's going to be very far off. Having talked for 36 verses about those two things, he then tells us to be prepared, to be ready. So he says in verse 40, Matthew 24, verse 40, then two men will be in the field, one will be taken, one will be left. So be prepared is the message, be ready. Two women will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken, one will be left. Okay, be ready, be prepared. And he says, watch therefore, for you do not know what hour your Lord is coming, in the next verse, verse 42. So be prepared, be prepared. When you come down to verse 45, it's simply a little parable that contrasts a faithful and wise servant in verse 45 with an evil servant in verse 48. And the one is preparing for his master's return, the other, the evil one in verse 48, isn't preparing. So it's the same theme. If you go on to the next chapter, chapter 25, you have the parable of the wise and foolish virgins, which is again saying the same thing, be ready, be prepared for our Lord's return. And then in verse 14, the parable of the talents, again, telling us to be prepared and to use the gifts that God has given us to the best of our ability. I see nothing here establishing some sort of organization, which, by the way, there are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different organizations. The Mormon Church claim that God established their organization in the year 1830. The Seventh-day Adventist, I think it was 1853 or 1863, that God established the Seventh-day Adventist movement as the sole channel, you know, the sole mediator between God and man. Christadelphianism, that was established in the 1860s or the 1870s. The Way International, founded by Victor Paul Werwell, that was established in the 1950s. There's a host of different groups. And don't get me started on Pentecostalism, because that's going absolutely insane through the New Apostolic Reformation movement, where, again, they claim God is speaking to people. And God is appointing all of these people as apostles and prophets in our own day, and God's speaking to them all the time. Funny thing is, what God says to one group, he says something totally different to another group.
Yeah.
Which makes me think it's all just the teachings of men. It's all a lot of hot air. But Matthew 45, Matthew chapter 24, verse 45. Who then is a faithful and wise servant? The servant's appointed, right? After the master's return. So when the master returns, then he's going to make him ruler over all his goods. Now, Christ hasn't returned yet. So if there is a faithful and wise servant who's going to be appointed, and I strongly believe that's not the case, this is just a parable. When is that faithful and wise servant going to be returned? Well, according to the parable, after the master's return. Now, Jesus hasn't returned yet. We're still waiting for the second coming of Christ. So I don't see any way, that Jesus could have appointed a faithful and wise servant in the year 1919, as the Watchtower claims.
That's another subject. Jesus returns. That's an interesting point you've raised there.
That's what this whole chapter is about. Matthew 24 is about the destruction of the temple and the return of Christ. And this parable about the faithful and wise servant in Matthew 24:45, which is contrasted to the evil servant in Matthew 24:48, is basically telling us that rewards and punishments are going to be given out after Christ's return. Now, the Watchtower is saying that the faithful and wise servant was appointed in 1919. That can't be. Firstly, I think this is a parable. It's not some office like Pope or head of the Mormon Church. But if this is an appointment,
you're aware of Are you aware of our view of Christ's return? I don't know if you've looked at that at all.
I would prefer to stick to the faithful and wise servant. Could we stick to that? If this is an office like the office of Pope, where Christ is going to nominate 8 men to the office similar to the papacy, and that's going to happen in 1919, then Christ would have had to have returned before 1919, because the faithful and wise servant is going to be made ruler over all his goods, verse 48, after Christ's return. And Christ has not returned. We haven't had the second coming of Christ yet.
Well, so, yeah, it's very relevant then to refer to Christ's return. Because, of course, Matthew 24, so Jesus was asked, when will these things be? What will be the sign of your presence and the conclusion of the system of things? And then Jesus gave the sign, didn't he? Nation rise against nation, kingdom against kingdom, and so on. So, yeah, that would be the start of the last days, the ride of the four horsemen, and other Bible writers referred to. And the time, well, the question was, what would be the sign of your presence? You're actually being on hand, royal presence.
The sign of your coming, not presence, it's coming. The sign of your coming. It's referring to the second coming of Jesus Christ, the return of Jesus Christ to this world, which hasn't happened yet. If it had happened, then the Bible says everyone will see him. The whole world will see him. Well, that hasn't happened yet.
Not that returning, that's right, yeah. But this returning in Matthew 24, which is the one we're focused on. It's interesting that word parousia, presence. I don't know if you've
It doesn't mean presence. It means his return.
There's obviously different opinions on right. that. But I think with this again, I'm not sure. You said you're looking, Robert. When I said you're searching for the truth, or do you feel you've already found? You're coming across as someone that's definitely sure about what you believe to be the truth and not the truth. So I'm just wondering what the aim of the discussion is, really.
Well, so are you. You're coming across as someone who's very definite about the truth.
Yeah, I am. I definitely am. Yeah. I admit that. Certain things are non-negotiable, and it's pointless discussing them, because and unless you want the understanding or clarification as to why we believe certain things. But I've had a futile debate about things of this nature that just end up going absolutely nowhere, because basically a person who's all, if you're speaking to somebody who's already made up their mind,
can we just forget about making up our mind and just discuss one thing and one thing only? Chapter 54 of your book is titled The Role of the Faithful and Discreet Slave. Could we discuss that rather than just go off topic and talk about discussions or what other people have told us? Can we just stick to that, please, sir?
It's one thing leads to another, though. Yeah, that's the thing. You have to understand one thing to get the next thing. Yeah, Christ's return is a key element. You've mentioned that about 6 times in what you just said previously. So it's very relevant to the whole point. We can't make an assumption. That way, we can't go on from there, assuming, what you say, Christ doesn't return until, never. So he's not returned yet. We believe that he has already returned in 1914 as King of God's Kingdom. So, but we appreciate there's other alternative viewpoints, and obviously come to very different conclusions. And if you have, that's fine. We'll leave you to that, but we beg to differ and continue on. But
could you prove to me that Christ returned in 1914? You're saying Christ returned to this earth in 1914. Is that what you're saying?
Invisibly as a king in heaven. Yeah.
Hang on. I asked you, did Christ return to this earth in 1914? And you said, quote, yes, invisibly in heaven. I never asked you about heaven. I asked you, did Christ return to this earth?
I'm sorry that this conversation has to end. Goodbye.